recognizing, God, that you are not only the creator of everything that we know and experience in this life, but Father, within us, God, you are creating a life, Father, that is eternal, Lord, that supersedes, Father, all the cares and concerns of this world, Father, that you have established a communion, Father, a connection with us through your Son, our Savior, Christ Jesus, and his sacrifice on the cross of Calvary, and the life, God, that he imparts. Father, thank you for making everything new, for being the God of the new, Father, for pointing us and giving us a hunger and a thirst for what you will do and what you will bring into our lives and into the world and from this world, Father. Father, life eternal in the heavens, in a house not made with hands. Father, we praise you. We thank you. We ask that you meet us here in the name of Jesus. And we all said, amen. Please be seated and turn in your Bibles to Joshua, the book of Joshua, chapter 17, as we pick up where Pastor Luke so capably left off last week in chapter 17 of Joshua. I've really missed you guys. Missed not being here over the past several weeks. We, as Luke has shared, are moving, and we are so excited to be close, finally answering our prayer, being close to the church and you all in our home. So, the book of Joshua, exciting stuff, you know, with the example of the children of Israel being brought into this land, of promise, battling to possess their possession, right? The possession that had been purposed for them. We saw with the example of Caleb, you know, an example of a man being sold out, being totally sold out for the things of God, and how God can awesomely use that, how he honors that, how he honors those who honors him. And then last week, we saw that devastating toll of compromise, you know, and as Harry cued us into, there are the sermons are downloadable on YouTube, and I downloaded it and was able to listen to Pastor Luke getting physically sick in front of y'all, almost puking in front of y'all. Now, I'll tell you what, I've been pastoring for almost 20 years here. And, you know, I've been nauseous when I've been up here, but I've never caused myself to be nauseous for a purpose of illustration. So there is a crown of glory awaiting this man, you know, who would do that for us. It was so funny. You could hear it in his voice. He was not feeling so well. In order to demonstrate what? In order to demonstrate to us the incompatibility of living in the spirit and living after the flesh. They're just totally incompatible, all in all, over the past several weeks, and for that matter, for the entire course of this study, the book of Joshua, beautifully and wonderfully illustrating to us what? Illustrating, again, that life, that place that God purposes for his children that God purposes for you and I. It's the place of blessing. It's pictured for us in this land beyond the Jordan, to the west of the Jordan, this land of promise, this land of Canaan, picturing again for us that Spirit-filled life that Jesus, our Yahshua, our Joshua, came to bring. It's the life that Jesus imparted to his disciples in John chapter 20. Do you remember the account? The disciples, you know, followers, faithful followers of Jesus throughout his earthly ministry. And then he was crucified. He died and rose again and met his disciples there in John chapter 20. And what did he do? He breathed on them. Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Receive ye the Holy Spirit. And at that point in time, the disciples were taken beyond a mere familiarity, a mere knowledge of the promise that Jesus gave them in John chapter 17. He took the disciples into the experience of actually realizing this Holy Spirit in a real way. It wasn't just a thought. It wasn't just a figment. It was an experience. And as Pastor Luke pointed out, yeah, this life that we're called to live in the land of promise, you know, it's gonna be difficult at times. We're gonna be challenged at times. But it's life with rewards. It's life with rewards that go far beyond what we could experience otherwise, that we could even fully comprehend. For us, the application is clear. The battle has been won on the cross of Calvary. Our Yahshua, our Joshua. The name Jesus is the anglicized version of the Hebrew Yeshua, Joshua. And it's our Joshua, our Yeshua, that brought us victory on the cross of Calvary. On the cross of Calvary, the enemy, our enemy, has been defeated. Satan is a defeated foe, even now. And yet, what? He wiles and tries everything in his ability to insulate us from the victory that's already ours. It's already ours. And yet, through circumstance, he will try to take our vision off of what has already been given to us. As the Apostle Paul reminds us in Romans 8:31, he says, if God be for us, who can be against us? Greater is he that is in you through the indwelling presence of that Holy Spirit than he that would come against you. And so in chapter 17, as Pastor Luke pointed out, you know, it's all about the apportioning of the land. It's all about the dividing up of the land. That land is significant. It is that very same land that was promised to Abraham way back in Genesis chapter 12. Do you remember that? You know, where the Lord, you know, appears to Abram at that time. His name was Abram. It had not yet been changed to Abraham. He says, Abram, get ye out of that country. Get ye out of the country, from your kindred, from your father's house, and go to a land that I'm going to show you. It's a land that I'm going to show you, and in that land, I will make of thee a great nation, and bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless thee. I'll bless them that bless thee and curse them that curse thee, and in thee, in you, in your seed, Abram, all families, all nations of the earth will be blessed. The promise. And here it is. The land of promise, the land that was promised to Abraham, reaffirmed to his son Isaac, and then to his son Jacob. And then Jacob had 12 sons, right? Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, Asher, Issachar, Zebulun, Joseph, Benjamin. These 12 became the 12 tribes of Israel. These are the very same tribes that are being apportioned this land within the land of promise. And we've learned here that Joseph, remember, Joseph had two sons when he was in Egypt, right? Ephraim and Manasseh. Manasseh, his firstborn. Ephraim, his secondborn. And here in chapter 17, each of his sons, the sons of Joseph, are receiving their allotment. In chapter 16, Joseph's second son, Ephraim, you know, he took his possession. They, that tribe, took their possession. And now in 17, his first son, Manasseh, is poised to take theirs. So we're going to begin in verse 3. And in verse 3, we have a seemingly insignificant little detail that I believe looms large in our consideration of what's going on here. Verse 3, chapter 17 of Joshua, but Zelophehad, the son of Hephner, the son of Gilead, the son of Machir, the son of Manasseh, this Zelophehad, he had no sons, but daughters. And their names, these are the names of his daughters, Miklah, and Noah, and Haglah, and Michkah, and Tirzah. Don't ask me to repeat that. And they came near before Eleazar, the priest. He's the high priest at that time. And before Joshua, the son of Nun, and before the princes, saying, the Lord commanded Moses to give us an inheritance among our brethren. Therefore, according to the commandment of the Lord, he gave them an inheritance among the brethren of their father. And there fell 10 portions to Manasseh beside the land of Gilead and Bashan, which were on the other side of the Jordan. Remember, there was a half tribe of Manasseh that stayed on the east side of, or settled on the east side of the Jordan. But beside that, there was this allotment, these 10 portions on the west side. And we're told, verse 6, because the daughters of Manasseh had an inheritance among the son, his sons, and the rest of Manasseh's sons had the land of Gilead. So what's happening here? These daughters of Zelophehad. Zelophehad had died and had no sons. These daughters had no brothers, and that's an important distinction, because in that day and time, the inheritance was passed to the firstborn son. Specifically, without exception, the firstborn son in every family received the inheritance. So when Zelophehad died, with no sons being born to him, his daughters, they went to Moses. And that incident is recorded in Numbers chapter 27. They went to Moses and they said, you know, what do we do now? You know, our father has passed. There is no one to receive his inheritance. You know, we have no brothers. Father had no sons. Does that mean that our family's inheritance will be passed on to another, will be absorbed by the community around it? Does that mean that we don't get an inheritance? And so Numbers chapter 27, it tells us that Moses had to go to the Lord about that. So he scratched his head and said, wow, that's a good question. So he went to the Lord and he prayed and he sought the Lord, and the Lord met him and said to him that, yes, indeed, these daughters of Zelophehad would receive an inheritance. An inheritance among the tribe of Manasseh, that they would receive land. And furthermore, with the stipulation that should they marry, that they were to marry within the tribe of Manasseh so as to keep things tidy and neat and all within the land of Manasseh. So here, based upon that decision, based upon this time where this land was being apportioned, and these daughters are scratching their head thinking, what are we going to do now? These daughters, they appeal. They appeal to the high priest, right, Eleazar, to Joshua, and to the princes. You know, when I consider this, you know, I couldn't help but thinking about prayer. The appeal to righteousness, to these representatives of righteousness, to us today, to Christ Jesus himself. You know, and sometimes we pray and we think, you know, am I praying amiss? Am I praying presumptuously? Am I praying for something that perhaps I ought not be to pray for? You know, this is a selfish prayer, in fact. This is for an inheritance among the tribe of Manasseh. But when you think about what was happening here, they were praying according to what had already been decided. They were praying, in other words, according to God's will. You know, we're told in Scripture, if we pray according to God's will, we will receive anything that we ask. I remember praying for Donna, as you all were praying for Donna. And, you know, searching for those words during that time, and it was such a difficult time. And I remember praying. I remember praying according, I don't think I've ever shared this with Donna, but praying the prayer that was prayed in Acts when Tabitha, whose name was also named Dorcas, she was a servant of God. She was greatly used in the church there at that day and time, and she passed away. And those from the church were praying according to her utility in the church, Lord, that you would raise her, and she was raised from the dead. Lord, according to your mercy and grace, Lord, we need this woman. Father, raise her according to your mercy and grace, according to what you would have in this. And this is what is pictured to me in this prayer. And so you say, okay, you look back and you look at this incident and you say, okay, these daughters, they're coming before the high priest, before Joshua, before the princes. You know, they're in Israel, they're saying, we want our portion. And you say, so what? Just a minor little insignificant, this obscure little exchange between these daughters of Zelophehad and the leaders of Israel. But as we stop and consider this seemingly insignificant little detail, has far-reaching implications. They reach as far to the claim of Jesus to be the Messiah, to be the anointed one, to be the one that came to bear the sins of humanity. They reach all the way to Jesus' claim to be the son of David. Remember, as Jesus was making his way into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday, "Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, son of David." Jesus came as son of David to lay claim to that everlasting throne that was promised to David. Remember the Davidic covenant? That covenant that was made, you know, to David. Basically, it was God's promise to David and to Israel that the Messiah, that Christ Jesus, would come from the line, from the heritage, from the inheritance, from father to son, within the tribe of Judah, and would establish an everlasting kingdom, a kingdom without end. That's what Jesus came to do. That's what Jesus did. But in order for that to happen, that inheritance would have to go through who? It would have to go through a woman. Why is that? Because Jesus was born of a woman. Jesus was born of Mary. Joseph was not Jesus' biological father. He was born of the Spirit. And so because Matthew in his gospel, you read Matthew chapter 1 and you read that long list of names, right? That long begat, you know, Abraham begat Isaac, who begat Jacob, who begat, you know, Joseph, and on it goes. You know, it has 42 begats there. And it all is traced from David to verse 16 of that first chapter, where Matthew concedes. I'll read it. "And Jacob begat Joseph," Jacob being Joseph, the husband of Mary's father. "And Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ." What's that saying? Now, this is interesting. It's because, to get a little bit technical, it's given in the singular feminine voice, saying essentially what? Matthew is essentially saying that Jesus was not born of Joseph. Yes, this is the legal line to Joseph, but he wasn't, even though he is born to Joseph, he wasn't born of Joseph. Instead, because it's given in the singular feminine voice, he was born of Mary. It was a reiteration of the virgin birth here. And so the rabbis, as they were opposing Jesus, they couldn't make a legal claim against Jesus' right to the throne. Because of what? Because of the groundwork, because of this little obscure incident that happened back in Numbers and was claimed here in Joshua chapter 17, where the daughters of Zelophehad laid claim to an inheritance. That women were not to be disqualified from the lineage. And on top of that, the genealogy of Jesus, specifically through Mary, is laid out for us in Luke's gospel from David, King David, not through his son Solomon, as Joseph was traced, but through another son, Nathan, from King David to Mary, the mother of Jesus, the lineage, the spiritual lineage to the throne. Why are we all saying that? Why am I even mentioning this morning? Well, I believe because it's reminding us of something that we often forget. It's reminding us of who makes everything new. It's reminding us of who sits on the throne. It's reminding us, as you think back to your life and you think about the travesties that you have endured, think about the setbacks, think about the unfairness, and sometimes we can dwell on those things. It's so unfair that this happened to me. As you think about those things, we think about the sovereignty of the Lord and how the Lord uses insignificant little details in our lives, from our lives, to our lives, to accomplish great and wonderful things. We're reminded just who it is that's at work, right? Because the Lord causes all things, right? All things to work together for good, right? Just who it is that is at work. Just who it is that worketh in you. Philippians 2:13, both to will and to do for his good pleasure. You see, the Lord is accomplishing things in you. From those obscure little details, you couldn't even begin to think. And so, you know, I do. Sometimes I ask, why, Lord? Why is this happening? And sometimes he reveals it to me in short order, sometimes years and years later, and sometimes I think that the final answer will be in the eternity future. But he's using it to cause monumental shifts of good to come into our lives. And so what's left for us? What's the application here? That we serve a God who is omniscient, who is omnipotent, who is all-knowing, who is all-powerful, who doesn't let one insignificant little detail come into our lives that he can't use for his glory and for our good. It's back to old Proverbs 3, 5-7. Trust in that Lord of the small and insignificant, as well as the great and glorious. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not in your own understanding, and always acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Be not wise in thy own eyes. Fear the Lord. Depart from evil, to fear the Lord, to reverence the Lord. What are we to fear? Are we to fear the future? Well, we look at things that are happening, you know, in our nation, we can say, oh, that's pretty fearful. But are we to fear the future? No. Are we to fear the past? No. You know, are we to fear death, or even life, our angels, our principalities, our power, our things present, our things to come? No. Romans 8:39, nothing shall separate us from the love of God, which is through Christ Jesus our Lord. So the next time you fear the future, you're tempted to fear, instead, try this. Try rejoicing. What? Try rejoicing in a God who's sovereign. Rejoice. Rejoice in what? Rehearse what the Lord has accomplished. Rehearse those answered prayers. Rehearse and rejoice in what God is able to do that we can't do. And so we're to fill our minds with the sovereign God. He is creator. He is creator God, Romans 1:25. Creator God who will be blessed forever. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews 13:8, his years will never end. Psalm 102:27. You know, he's king. He's the supreme ruler. He's sovereign. He knows the beginning from the end and everything in between. You know, he's the Lord of history. You know, he doesn't have any advisors. He doesn't need a Congress. He doesn't need a majority within Congress. He's the one in charge. He is sovereign. He is God. And he imparts to us the inside track to peace. You know, others, you know, see problems in this world and they clench their fists. What's a Christian to do? We're to fall on our knees, right? We're to bend our knees and praise the God who's sovereign over all. And then in verses 7 through 13, we saw these borders, you know, being established between Ephraim and Manasseh, with the danger of the compromise that Pastor Luke had alluded to last week, which brings us to chapter 17, verse 14. Read with me if you would. Then the children of Joseph spoke to Joshua, saying, who are the children of Joseph? Ephraim and Manasseh, the tribes of Ephraim and Manasseh. They spoke to Joshua, saying, why have you given us only one lot and one share to inherit? Since we are a great people, and as much as the Lord has blessed us unto now. And Joshua says, you're going to love this. This is like a dad. If you're so great, if you're such a great people, then go up to the forest country and clear a place for yourself there in the land of the Perizzites and the giants, since the mountains of Ephraim are too confined for you. But the children of Joseph said, the mountain country is not enough for us, and all the Canaanites who dwell down in the land of the valley have chariots of iron, both those who are of Beth Shean and its towns and those who are of the valley of Jezreel. Chariots of iron, giants, so much that they're confronting. And Joshua reminds them of something in verse 17. Joshua spoke to the house of Joseph, to Ephraim and Manasseh, saying, you are a great people and have great power. You shall not have only one lot, but the mountain country shall be yours. Although it is wooded, you shall cut it down, and its farthest extent shall be yours, for you shall drive out the Canaanites, though they have iron chariots and are strong. What's the issue here? I tell you, it's the same issue that confronts us all. Has not God shown himself strong in your life in the past? Raise your hand. God has shown himself strong, has he not? And so when we confront those issues, so often we take God out of the equation. There are chariots of iron. Chariots of iron were the most sophisticated armament of warfare in that day and time. Chariots of iron, horses and chariots, and what do we have? Spears and bows and arrows? Come on. We are no match for these inhabitants of this hill country. And Joseph says, you know what? You are. Because you have something that they don't. You have the Lord your God. You have Jehovah God in your midst. But when we take God out of the middle, you know, the scriptures replete with examples of people running into difficulty, right? People facing evil. They face evil. They realize God and they are given victory. Evil, God, good. Evil, God, good. Time and time again. It's a pattern of Scripture. Evil ahead, God is trusted, and good results. In our study of Job, remember that study? Evil came to Job, unprecedented evil. You know, and he was tempted, and he was tried, and he was tested. And Job, he struggles and struggles and struggles. But God counters. He spoke truth. He declared his sovereignty. And Job, in the end, he chooses God. And what follows is good. Satan's prime target becomes God's star witness. In the same way, evil came to David, right? When David fell, you know, into sin, he committed adultery. Evil came to Daniel when he was carried away into Babylonian captivity. Evil came to Nehemiah when the walls of Jerusalem were destroyed. But God countered. And because he did, David became the sweet psalmist of Israel. You know, writing psalms, songs of grace. And Daniel rose to be the ruler in Babylon. And Nehemiah, he rebuilt Jerusalem with Persian money. He rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem. Good happened. Because God was realized. When God gets in the middle of life, evil becomes good. And so here they are complaining, and yet the words spoken from Joshua to these tribes of Joseph, yeah, it's going to be difficult. But you know what? God's going to go with you, and you will be victorious. But it takes something. Go do it. There it is. Go do it. Joshua's response was tough, but then it was tender as well. You are great. You can do this. Chapter 18. The whole congregation of Israel assembled together in Shiloh and set up the tabernacle of the meeting there. And the land was subdued before that. Shiloh was kind of smack dab in the middle of Canaan. And so they set up the tabernacle there. And the land was subdued. But there remained among the children of Israel seven tribes. How many sons did Jacob have? 12? How many tribes right here had not received their inheritance in verse 2? Seven. Seven tribes, seven of the 12 had not yet received their inheritance. Why? Well, Joshua said to the children of Israel, "How long will you neglect to go and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers has given you? It's yours. How long are you going to take to possess it? Pick out from among you three men of each tribe, and I will send them, and they shall rise and go throughout the land, survey it according to their inheritance, and come back to me, and they shall divide it up in seven parts. Judah shall remain in the territory to the south, and the house of Joseph shall remain in the territory to the north. You shall therefore survey the land in seven parts and bring the survey here to me that I may cast lots for you here before the Lord our God. But the Levites, those Levites, shall have no part in it, for the priests of the Lord is their inheritance." So Joshua is saying, Levites, you're not getting land. I'm not clumping you together in a tribe, in a community. You are going to lay hold. You're going to inherit cities throughout the whole land. So you will be dispersed through the whole land of Israel as priests to serve amongst God's people, to be where God's people are. But the Levites shall have no part among you, for the priesthood of the Lord is their inheritance. And Gad and Reuben and the half tribe of Manasseh have received their inheritance beyond the Jordan on the east, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave them. And then the men arose, and Joshua charged those who went out to survey the land, saying, go walk through the land, survey it, and come back to me that I may cast lots for you here before the Lord in Shiloh. So the men went out, passed through the land, and wrote the survey in a book in seven parts by cities, and they came to Joshua in the camp of Shiloh. Then Joshua did what? He cast the lots for them before the Lord, and Joshua divided up the land of the children of Israel according to their divisions. And so, these seven tribes, they're a little slothful, aren't they? They're not taking possession. They're in the congregation of Israel. They're in the congregation of faith. And yet, they're not stepping forward in faith. I believe it's the same thing. It's the same scenario described in the Lord's letter to the seven churches of Asia, specifically in Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 21, where the Lord is describing the lukewarm heart, the heart of that Laotian church. You know, that attitude manifests by a lackadaisical attitude. The Laotians, the Lord says, you're neither hot nor cold. And that bore, you know, a lot of application to them in that day and time, because there were hot springs there near Laodicea. Hot springs were good for what? Bathing, you know, heating, warming. They had hot springs, cold water they lacked, because the nearest spring was some 6 miles away, and by the time it got there, it became lukewarm, not good for refreshing, and not good for reinvigorating. It was, in fact, nauseating, and that's why the Lord goes on to say, to those who are half-hearted, I will spew you out of my mouth. The lukewarm are those who claim to know God, but live as though he does not exist. And so, as Joshua did, as he exhorted the children of Israel, those seven tribes, to inherit, take possession of their possession, Jesus, in probably the harshest of the seven letters to the seven churches, gives them an indictment of their deeds, that indeed they were spiritually wretched and pitiful and poor and blind and naked, even though they were wealthy beyond all the other churches. They had become a church that was half-hearted. And so the application to us is, serve the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, that we're to be about the Lord's business and be passionate about that business. The rest of the chapter is the apportioning of those seven territories among the children of Israel. And so I'd ask that you join me in prayer right now. Lord God, we thank you, Lord, that you are the God of yesterday, today, and forever. The God who is worthy of our praise. The God who created, who sustains, who will bring to fruition this world. Father, our lives. Father, your purpose here in this world. And Father, I pray that as we go forward, we would go forward with reflective hearts, Lord, as we realize, God, that there is no fugitive molecule in this entire universe, that you are indeed sovereign. And Father, that nothing that has happened, will happen, is outside of your control. And in fact, Father, you use those insignificant little things in life to do things that are beyond our wildest imaginations. Father, they become pivot points in our lives and in the life of your church, Father, in the life of this church here. And so, Father, we have no other place, no other thing but to thank you for being a God who is firmly in control, Father. Give us hearts to receive, eyes to see what you would be telling us specifically this morning. In Jesus' name we pray.